السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: ومن آياته أن خلق لكم من أنفسكم أزواجا لتسكنوا إليها، وجعل بينكم مودة ورحمة، إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يتفكرون. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O slaves of Allah, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can a believer attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa. And then it is indeed incumbent upon all of us to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the numerous bounties and favors that he has conferred upon us. For if an individual were to try to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him, he would fail. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you were to try to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would fail to encompass all of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from these blessings, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, comes the blessing of the beautiful bond of nikah. The ayah that I recited in the beginning, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ, until the end of the ayah, it is upon us to ponder and reflect on the words of our powerful maker. Allah the Almighty, he says in another place in the Noble Quran, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Allah the Almighty, he did not say, أَفَلَا يَسْمَعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, do y'all not hear the Qur'an? He did not say, أَفَلَا يَقْرَؤُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, do y'all not recite the Qur'an or do y'all not read the Qur'an? Nay, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he used the word تَدَبُّر. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Do you all not ponder and reflect on the Noble Quran? تَدَبُّر, to ponder, to reflect. أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, or are there locks on your heart? Are your hearts sealed up that they cannot ponder and reflect on the words of your powerful maker? So it is upon us to ponder on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty, he says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. And it is from his signs, it is from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he created for you all, مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا, from within yourselves, spouses, mates, partners. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. For what purpose? For what reason? لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. So that you may find tranquility. so that you may find peace, so that you may find happiness by them. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So it is indeed a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For if Allah the Almighty had wished, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Allah the Almighty, He could have created us like some single-celled organism, like amoeba or some bacteria, to reproduce individually by ourselves, where we would have no need towards a mate, where we would have no need towards a spouse. But Allah in His infinite wisdom, He created us in such a manner that we cannot exist in this world without a mate. We cannot reproduce without a partner. It is out of the infinite wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He created us as such. It is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why He says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ. It is from His sign. Now the thing is, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala generally come with trials. The blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala come with tests. At the end of the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wishes to polish us to the better, to prepare us for something better, and likewise to reward us and also to test us. So marriage comes with its share of tests and trials. For remember that our bonds of marriage, our bonds of nikah, are not like the kuffar saying, till death do us part. They have it inscribed on their rings, till death do us part. No, our bonds of marriage were sealed off in the heavens. The matchmaker was none other than our beloved maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And our marriages, our bonds, are supposed to last for an eternity. They begin in this world and traverse on to the next hereafter, the eternal akhirah, the eternal hereafter, and last for an eternity. But it is upon us to work on our relationship, to concrete our relationship, so that they last for an eternity. So today's khutbah, the few minutes that I've got remaining, I wish to share a few tips, or you could call it prescriptions, towards enhancing one's marriage. The same ayah that I recited in the beginning, Allah the Almighty goes on to say, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And Allah the Almighty, He placed between you all, between the two spouses, مَوَدَّةً and رَحْمَةً. Now these are two different Arabic terms. They do not mean the same thing. They do not mean love. مَوَدَّةً means something and رَحْمَةً means another thing. مَوَدَّةً means passionate love, whilst رَحْمَةً is mercy, as we all know. So the choice of words, Allahu Akbar, Allah the Almighty, He says, we have placed between the two spouses, mawadda and rahma. The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that marriage is a cycle between these two elements, between mawadda and rahma. For in the very beginning, when a couple gets together, when two spouses marry one another, what happens? They're full of bubbly young love. But then after a few years, maybe after a few pregnancies, or maybe even after a small argument or a small problem, the love, in a sense, the levels of love may decrease a bit. But that does not mean that immediately that the two spouses must resort to divorce. No. At that point, rahmah comes in and recharges the levels of love back to 100%. This is a cycle between love and mercy. How does mercy play its role there? The wife looks at the husband, oh, he's the breadwinner. At the end of the day, every single morning he goes to work, he earns money, he brings bread home at the end of the day, he looks after my children, he pays for the rent, the school fees, the school tuition. Mercy. She looks at her husband, she respects him, and even if it's a small problem, a small issue, it gradually diminishes and vanishes away. Likewise, the husband looks at the wife, oh, she's my beloved wife. She bore so many children for me. She went through all of those hardships, those pregnancies, all for me. She washes my clothes. She cooks for me. She looks after my children. She manages my household. Whilst in reality, none of these are her responsibilities at the end of the day. So he feels mercy towards her, and that recharges the levels of love back to 100%. It is a cycle between mawadda and rahma. That is point number one. Point number two, is in regard to positivity versus negativity. Psychologists mention that in a relationship, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that the levels of positivity must be high. Must be high. Once two psychologists, they conducted an experiment, a private experiment between themselves, in the sense between the husband and the wife. They determined that for 1 month, we're not going to give in to any form of negativity, whatever it may be. At the end of the month, they realized that for the whole month, they hadn't conversed much. Because negativity takes so many forms, such as criticism, such as looking down upon one another, such as rude remarks. All of these tiny things, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, are those things that blow out of proportion and result in a separation. Today we see couples separating over petty issues, such as the husband not squeezing the toothpaste tube from the middle instead of squeezing it from the bottom. And perhaps because he's not having proper table manners, or perhaps because he's snoring or yawning. Tiny things, maybe it may sound funny or might sound insignificant, but these are the issues that lead to arguments, lead to things that are blown out of proportion, and finally they decide to separate ways. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, positivity levels must be high. Let me give you an example. A man, he works, he comes in the evening tired. The minute he opens the door, all of us men, we wish that our wives should welcome us with a happy, warm smile. That's what we expect. This is how positivity vibes, in other words, vibrations work. Now see, as long as I am positive, I'm going to engage all of you all and keep you all positive too. In the same way, as long as you all are positive and you all grasp what I'm saying, I also feel positive. The vibrations basically. But if I am negative, I'm going to make you all also negative. And if in the same way, if you all are negative, you all are going to make me negative. Positivity, negativity. So the man, he comes home, he's expecting his wife to welcome him with a warm, happy smile. He opens the door, she welcomes him with a warm, happy smile. Alhamdulillah, the day is fine. All of that stress, all of that tension, he leaves it behind the door and enters home, heart lightened. But on the other hand, if he were to enter home and the wife welcomes him with a frown, "What took you so long? Why are you so late?" He would retort back saying, "Don't you know that there is so much of traffic on the street? Or you know, the train got late. Or I was waiting for the bus. Or I had some work at office." Something would come flying back, and every single issue, he would look at the children and he would say, "Why are you looking happy? Don't you have any homework to do? Go away." This is how things blow out of proportion. Just as how we expect our wives to welcome us with a warm, happy smile, we too need to be giving the same treatment to them, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Because marriage is not a one-way street. It's not only getting, but rather give and then get. It's a two-way street. It's a two-way street. And after all, our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that a smile is a sadaqah. It's not going to cost us $1 million. After all, what harm is there in showing some teeth, in showing a nice, beautiful smile? And that too, to the companion who is by our side, our beloved wife. Why can't we smile? Why can't we smile? This brings the levels of positivity higher. The next point, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is the reassurance of love. See, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us men. We are logical creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, even at a time when there is an argument, we in general, we want to place all of the evidence on top of the table and sort it out, talk it out like how men do. But women, on the other hand, Allah the Almighty has created them very emotional. At times you would find her crying and you'd ask her, "Why are you crying?" "I don't know." "Why are you crying?" "I don't know." She does not know why she's crying. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created women emotional. So it is upon men to understand that. And women, they need to be reassured that they are loved by their husbands. We men, we think that I go in the morning to work, I toil so hard, I'm paying for the rent, I'm paying for the school fees, the tuition, I bring groceries home. These are all manifestations of my love. Why on earth do I have to come home in the evening and tell her, "Darling, I love you," every single day? This is how we think. But my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we men, they need that reassurance. Those three magical words that we say at the evening, in the night, I love you, carries a long way. Because we men, our trains of thought, the way we think, in general, if we have a problem, we want to sort it out and then move to the next problem. That's how we work. That's how our train of thought runs. In other words, say if a man were to have a tiff with his wife this evening, the next day he could go to work and perform just as well as how he performed the day before. Because men, we can compartmentalize. We can push something into a side. That's how psychologists say. We can push all of these emotions into one compartment and focus on another problem. But women, on the other hand, as we know very well, they multitask. They multitask very well. A good example, whilst you're at work, can men work on Microsoft Word, for example, typing up a speech, and simultaneously work on a spreadsheet on Excel, and likewise reply emails from your customers, and also post statuses on Facebook? Is it possible? Can we multitask? Perhaps with the new range of Samsung Note 3s and things like that, multitasking is very easy. But still, men cannot multitask. We want to focus on one thing, solve it, move to the other. But have you noticed, Allah the Almighty has blessed women in such a way that they tend to cook 2 or 3 curries on the stove, all right? Managing the issues of children, getting them ready for school, packing their food, their bags, their homework, all of that, and also tending to her husband's needs. She sends him off also happily. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created women in such a way that they multitask. And likewise in terms of emotions, you might have noticed in an argument, very rarely women forget things. They bring things from all over the place. It just started off with one tiny fight, but so many issues would come. Because women are creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who are like that. They jump from point A to point B to point C. But we men, we think, let's sort out point A and then move to point B. This is how arguments work. So at the end of the day, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is upon us to understand how women work. And even arguments are inevitable, fights are inevitable. As long as we fight fair, as long as we fight healthy, those fights become constructive. Those fights become constructive, and at the end of the day, they catch up soon. The fight does not go on to the next day. So reassuring our love is very important in a relationship. Finally, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I have about 2 other points, but I'm running out of time. The last point which I wish to touch on is that we are supposed to be gentlemen. Where has the chivalry gone to, in these days? I mean, at the beginning of a marriage, yes, of course, everything is nice and bubbly, so there's a lot of love and all of these things. But as time goes on, I mean, all of those vanish. You don't dress up for one another anymore. You don't want to look smart for one another. There is no zing in the relationship. That's how relationships gradually die. I mean, even in an argument, it is upon us. If there are 10 bad things, there are bound to be other 90 good things. So why can't we focus on the positive? This is also part of being a gentleman. And likewise, look at our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So at the end of the day, all of this is benchmarked to his life. For he was the best husband. He was the best role model. He was the best teacher, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And if we adopt his life as our life, we are bound to be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. Our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was by a camel. And you know how tall a camel is. His wife, if I'm not mistaken, Safiya radiallahu anha, she wanted to climb on top of the camel. What Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did, he knelt down and he placed his thigh as a stepping stone for his wife, Safiya radiallahu anha, to help her climb on top of the camel. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we don't have camels today, but at least can we not open the door for our wives? Sadly, we see men today coming by the house and honking away, expecting their wives who are busy in the kitchen to come running to open the gate. And likewise, they stop the car, they sit in the car in the air condition, and they make their
weak wives get down and open a rusty gate for them to coolly put the car in. Whilst we are supposed to be doing that. We Muslims are supposed to be doing that. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the other day somebody was saying that if you see a man opening the door for his wife, there are two reasons. There are two reasons. Either the car must be new, or else the wife must be new. The car must be new, or the wife must be new. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we have to be gentlemen in a relationship. Because these are the little things that secure a strong relationship. These are the little things that enhance a marriage and carry it a long way. Finally, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, all of these tiny tips boil down to a very main ingredient, and that is to adopt a life of taqwa. To adopt a life of taqwa. For it is only through a life of taqwa can an individual attain success in this world and the hereafter, like I mentioned in the beginning. So in a relationship too, if a person brings in taqwa, naturally he is going to follow the teachings of our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The minute he brings in the teachings of our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is going to perfect his life in such a manner, he is going to be following the best of husbands, the best of teachers, the best of role models. Allahu Akbar. Naturally his life is going to be an example for others. And he is going to attain success in this world and the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill all of our marriages with happiness, with love and unity. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen our marriages. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all of our good deeds. And may he unite us in the gardens of Jannah. Wa akhir da'wayan.